is Gurdev Lakshmi, there is Santana Lakshmi, you know, there is Bhagya Lakshmi. So the idea of richness is something which maybe all of us have to expand our minds, that we are all rich in ways that we never even recognize. So anyway, so those two small corrections in good humor. Music is a gift bestowed on us. For me, it's my exceptionally, it's my bhagya, it's a great blessing for me. So many times when people say you have done this, you have done that, in absolute objective terms, you know, these are all opportunities which presented themselves to me. These are, if at all I have some music in me, it is not on account of my efforts at all. The gift is not due to any doing of mine. My intelligence, musical and otherwise, is again a given to me. My parents, their sacrifices, their efforts in putting me through the rigor of classical music is also, credit is due to them, not to me. My exceptionally generous gurus, who taught me so, with so much love and so much of unconditional giving, is again something which was not my choice. It was not my doing at all. So I sometimes feel that credit given to me is not due. It is due to other people. So I actually have not prepared anything much. So I should just bring it, as we say. Like I said, being born into a family which has a very strong predisposition to music is a great blessing. So my mother was a very accomplished singer. My father was an exceptionally talented bhajanist, though he was not formally trained in classical music. From very young age, in his village in Palakkad in Kerala, he always used to sing, you know, all the bhajana mandalis and, you know, sampradaya bhajana. One of the reasons he chose my mother as his wife was that he could make sure that his children had that genetic advantage. And my mother was also a very great teacher. So she was, and I still consider to be, my most important guru. So being the third among four children, my elder sister, she started playing the violin at a very young age, at the age of four. My elder brother, who started learning vocal along with me when I was three and he was five. Then me, and then my younger brother who joined. So this opportunity to learn, the commitment and sacrifice on the part of the parents to make sure that the children have that gift of joy through music, gift of excellence through music, was a very, very, you know, serious commitment on their part. And so thanks to all, to my parents mainly. And like they say, and like I always believe, even in today's difficult times, good begets good. So the very pure and sacrificial intent and actions of my parents gave me very, very good gurus, very, very good teachers, who were so loving, who were so generous, and who instilled Expertise and knowledge is one thing, but instill the great sense of value and joy in preciousness that our classical music requires to be. Classical music is not something which is to be enjoyed alone, or it's not something which is sensual and gives you relaxation or something like that. It is that, but it is much more than that. It's a very enriching, empowering, elevating force. Like all knowledge is. Knowledge is not just so that you can earn a livelihood, right? Knowledge is so that you can empower yourself to reach higher planes of existence. So I started learning the violin at a very young age, at the age of 3. All of us know that the fastest and most efficient learning happens at very, very young ages. The more complex the learning, the earlier it has to be. That's why we master, if you have the opportunity to learn 5-6 languages, you know, I see children who can master 5, 6, 7, 8 languages by the time they are 4 and 5. Maybe not the script. Language is such a complex system of learning. You try learning a language after you're 40, you will be struggled with it. You might have degrees and degrees and you might consider yourself very, very intelligent. But try learning a language at an advanced age and you will know how difficult it is. I know it because I started learning to write Tamil much later and Sanskrit even later. But music is like that. Music is such a classical music is such a complex entity. That learning it requires that you learn it in total. What is referred to as gestaltic learning. Where you don't learn by parts, you don't learn by method. You absorb it like a sponge in totality. That's how we learn language. A child learns to speak his or her mother tongue, not by knowing the grammar or the spelling or the commas or punctuation or anything. It is just learned in total. So classical music is one such thing. So my sister used to play the violin. She was elder to me by 5 years. The violin master who used to come home saw in me, I used to imitate what my sister was doing when I was 3, 3 and a half. With the ruler, with two scales. You know, this scale ruler, now it's called the ruler, right? Scale rule. Foot rule, no? So that. So I used to imitate with one hand one ruler and the other as the body of the instrument. I used to imitate and do the fingering. My sister's guru, who later also started teaching me, told my father, see, this 3-year-old boy is not just fooling around. His fingering is going, he's exactly what I'm teaching your daughter. So then he offered to teach me free his entire life. As long as this child wants to learn from me, it will be an honor for me to teach. So that's how violin came into my life. I don't remember any of this. We don't remember what we do at 3 and 5. But then this is what, there are some photos which prove it. So, there were black and white photographs at that time. So I started playing. Rigor was it was a very natural flow of life at that time. Classical music requires rigor. It requires sadhana, it requires practice. It requires constant, steady learning. If you're interested, I will. You know, the idea of learning classical music is so complete that if you learn classical music, your entire brain faculties, in terms of everything, they say right brain, left brain, all that, but everything just gets automatically developed. Because the methods by which the music enters you takes care of all that development. Whether it be creative, spatial, analytical,
memory wise, you know, the geography of it, the arithmetic of it. Because music involves all this. Not in such explicit terms. You know, speech wise, voice wise, expression wise, communication wise. Music develops all these faculties. My father instinctively knew that. Many, many great parents, all great musicians are because of the sacrifices and intuition and efforts of the parents. You can take that for granted. In fact, all great people who have achieved some levels of greatness in their respective fields are because of their parents and teachers. So that's the reason why, even for me, my academic excellence also was due to my music. Looking back, I will attribute I did very well in school. And I don't remember putting any great effort or my parents forcing me to work hard. Part of it can be attributed to a certain intelligence that you are born with. But a significant part of it is I attribute to music, classical music. Because it's learning of something as complex, but yet as synthesized as music, classical music is, it prepares the brain for a lifetime of learning, very productive learning, very efficient learning. So, I always stood first in class without much effort. And then, I used to learn, my elder brother started learning vocal and mridanga, so I used to learn that also. So, in a week, 6 days of the week, we had teachers come home, gurus come home. And my father was a very simple stenographer, secretary at Bharat Petroleum. More than 60% of his income went towards our musical teaching. Gurus taking us to concerts, buying recordings, etc., etc. So, but then it was not even, it never came across as any great giving up or anything. It was all done as if it is very sahaja, very natural. So that kind of, I don't even remember my parents ever telling me that I was good or congratulating me when I stood first or when I gave my first concert at the age of 8. By the time I was 15, I had given concerts almost in many parts of the world. But I don't remember them ever saying, wow, or well done, or things like that. Because it was, achievement was always part of the process of learning. Learning was the key thing. Achievement was always, accomplishment and achievement were only byproducts. That philosophy is very significant. That's also probably what prompted us to excel. My sister was a gold medalist in Bombay University in medicine, in surgery. She went on to do her FRCS and she was a very successful surgeon in the US. My other brother, we have this company called Karate Tales, which we do for children. We do a lot of products for children. He's also a very, very good singer. My younger brother passed out from IIT Bombay. He's faculty of IIT Bombay now, and he's also he keeps up his music also very active. So in the sense, in this first part of my this address, it is that very, very beautiful role of the parent that I revel in, that I pay homage to, and the role of the teacher. Then of course comes the idea that, like I said, I was learning vocal parte, violin and mridangam at the same time. This went on for about 8 to 9 years. So I'm quite a proficient mridangist also. Though I had to give it up because the mridangam required a harder touch because it's a force and strength based use of the hands. whereas the violin is requires for delicate touch. So because of this physical clash, my violin teacher told me that you have to choose one or the other. Because the violin was very, very dear to me, the choice was automatic. So then you can stop me at any time if this is getting boring. Okay. So academics and music went absolutely comfortably hand in hand. I make it a point to say this whenever, because it is very contrary to some of the attitudes that parents have, the anxiety that parents have, that during exam times they will just say, part class is boring up, we will focus on exams, preparation of exams. But that actually experts say is not the correct way to go about it. A happy child, a fulfilled child, means a child who excels in academics also. And music learning greatly accelerates and facilitates learning of everything else. Because it contains so much of mysteries of learning all packaged into one beautiful capsule, which also gladdens the heart, which brings joy to the child. You know, so then of course there is the logical flow of taking engineering if you excel. So after my 12th, but by the time from the age of 8, I started performing a lot, along with my brothers and sisters also, accompanying a lot of leading artists of that generation. I remember during my 12th exam, board exams, the great M.D. Ramanathan had come to Bombay by the way, I was born and brought up in Bombay, Mumbai. So he had a concert at Shanmukhanagar, which is one of the biggest Sabha's halls in Mumbai, hall which can seat 3,000 members of the audience. And the support and the love for classical music was so high that we had 6,000 members. Each day the hall would be full, 3,000 members on Saturday, on Sunday would be another, the remaining 3,000 members. So M.D. Ramanathan sir had come, the violinist slated for that evening's concert, there was a death in the family, he couldn't come. So my 12th board exams are going on. So there was an SOS call and then I was called to fill in. And then, I don't remember it very vividly, but I remember a Hindola that I played. I remember the blessing that M.D. Ramanathan gave me on stage, saying he looked up and said, you know, this is not being played by this child. So that kind of blessing. And he said, this Sri Ram Pere, Ramarod Ville, Avarod Ville, Illa Omadan. So those kinds of things happen to you because of a certain blessing. And so my father didn't even blink an eye, my parents didn't blink an eye when there was the opportunity when my 12th board was going on. So Friday I had an exam. Saturday morning I had an exam. From the exam hall I went to the concert hall, did the concert well, next day again concert. On Monday again I had my French exam. I remember that it was French, Monday. Because whatever I decided to prepare and revise on Saturday, Sunday I couldn't do it. So French I didn't do so well. But anyway, the idea that exams need not interfere in the path of the natural course of things as they happen to each other. Very difficult to put into practice. I struggle with it now. But then, that has so much of wisdom in it. And after that, of course, I did my PhD, I did my engineering, mechanical engineering, did very well in that also. I have a very simple approach to, many people look with awe at degrees and engineering and MBA especially. We are in this era of the last 50-60 years has given such an exalted state to these two, medicine, management and engineering, seem to enjoy a very undeserved status in terms of higher learning. Not much learning happens, actually, to be very honest. with the gifts endowed in terms of analytical ability, memory, quantitative, creative, we master the knack of learning, we master the knack of giving exams and succeeding. That's all. Probably political science or a study of a BA in history may be tougher. But then, because education is linked with survival and surviving better, more financially, more lucrative, these fields are enjoy a certain privilege. But that's not a logical conclusion, actually. That an engineer is more intelligent or academically at a higher status than any other field, or an MBA or whatever. You know, it's one of those societal things, trappings that we get into, stereotypes that we get into. So after my engineering, I got placed on campus in a couple of companies like HCL and Tata's. But I gave my entrance exams, CAT, for management. That is the prescribed path. See, many of the grooves that we choose, actually we don't choose. It's a trodden path. So after your engineering, if you've done well, and if you have a certain aptitude for giving these tests and doing well in them, then you follow that path, because it's attractive, it's sort of fun. So that's how I entered the IIMs also. IIM Calcutta. I had a choice between Bangalore and Calcutta. I chose Calcutta because I had been to Bangalore. I had not been to Calcutta. So I chose to go to Calcutta, and I did my finance and economics MBA in there. It was during that time that I had a certain clarity in terms of somebody wanted me to address this issue of how one comes about to choose when a human being has a choice presented to him or her as to what to do in life. This or either or, then there are certain situations and governing principles which make the individual choose. It was during my second year of at IIM that a certain clarity came, that my contribution to myself and to society would be far more if I chose to devote my energies to music. That was where I had come to a juncture where I had to choose. Till then I was a student. But a point comes where you want to put in more energies, study harder, and focus on a chosen stream in life. So, if I was born in a typical Bhagavatam family, then this dilemma is not there. Because, fourth order padichu porom, anyway, in Bhagavatam Apura, you want to be a singer, professional singer, that path is already chosen for you by your parents or by your lineage. But being in this position where, at the same time, I was also, my father was such a broad-minded person. Music of all kinds attracted him. And he felt that he was very attracted to the music of Kumar Gandharva, who was a great Hindustani singer. He was also attracted very deeply to Beethoven and Bach. So in my home, always all kinds of, even though I was being trained only in Carnatic music, all these musics I can still remember, listening to and enjoying, trying to even imitate. So at the age of 15, in the all-India radio competitions, I just for the fun of it entered also Hindustani music, because I was imitating it very well on my violin. Then I was first in Hindustani violin also. So Carnatic of course, and Hindustani also. So then automatically I got placed in what is called B high grade in All India Radio. So B high grade violin in Hindustani is not very common. So every 1.5 months I used to get a radio contract for radio programs. Now my invitation could take me only so far as the All the radio competitions. Now I have to start learning and preparing myself in the traditional way. That's when I started learning Hindustani music in the traditional Gurukula way. My guru, Pandit C.R. Vyas, Padma Bhushan Pandit C.R. Vyas. When I went to him, he said, I won't teach the violin, but I only sing. But Indian classical music is such a field that the music is one. Whether it is played on the sarod, or whether it is played on the veena, or whether it be is played, whether it is sung, the language is the same. It's the music what matters. It's the music that you learn. Of course, there is the element of technical mastery and knowing your instrument and getting better at it. But essentially what you learn is the music. So, I used to keep a violin. I used to keep a violin at his home. He was very, very generous. From college, from BJTI, I used to go directly to his home almost 4 times a week. He also never charged me for teaching. Because Vidya has always given us dhanam. That old style value was there. They lived very simple lives. And I used to go. His wife used to make me different tea because I'm coming straight from college, like they would do to their own son. And then I would have a class. And then my class will finish. Sometimes I will reach there by 5:36 after my engineering school. And then I will go there and I'll be at home at his home till 9. It is not like a class. It's like you are there. He will choose to teach. Sometimes he will be singing. You will be observing. Sometimes he will be teaching another student. You just sit and observe. Sometimes he will be massaging his feet. He'll say, so we will take care of his needs that way. So the guru is not just an imparter or an instructor. So the guru becomes a force within your life. That's why I use the word guru much more than teacher, because teacher also is very beautiful word. But then for me, guru has a significance which is much more than subject matter that I learn from him or from all of them. The preciousness and sanctity with which the reverence that they had for the music. So though we refer to Saraswati Mata as the goddess of music, it was not just a nominal or, it was not a nominal thing for them, that reference. They felt it very, very deeply that to be a musician you have to be chosen by her. And this you have got, and you have to be in reverence and gratitude throughout your life. So that those kinds of values that grow within you, that you don't consciously say, I want to be like that. Every time there is something which distracts me, even now they will enter my consciousness and say, what are you doing? So that kind of thing. Because they have entered your consciousness in that way. They are very precious to you. So that was my Hindustani training. And of course, after my, when during IIM, I chose that I wanted to spend more time with my music. Because I did a summer training in Citibank and it was very difficult for me. You know how Bombay is. I stayed in Chembur and my office was in what is called Sakhar, which is city. Wearing coat, tie and all that, and was very difficult for me to take because I'm working till 10 at night. So those 2 months, because I did a very good job, they offered me a permanent job later on. Without campus interviews, they offered me a job directly after I finished my first year of training there. But then I felt that this is not what I want to do. So the choice was very easy for me. And with my parents also, I just had to tell them that. And they kind of expected it all along. They were very happy for that choice. But then I was still in the learning mode. So I was exploring ways of knowing the violin in better ways. So,
can you fast forward to your romance of music in Berkeley?
No, I studied Wesleyan. Yeah, I studied my Western classical violin in what is called Firestone School of Music in Akron, Ohio. There again, my audition tape that I sent, I have no formal training, I have no degree in music. But I had approached for an MA, a Master of Music degree in Akron, Ohio. I cannot summarize what I did there. But I had to complete all my undergraduate courses for me to get my MA. So I had 232 credits of my undergrad You know what credits are in the US learning system? Subjects. So I had to do 32 credits of undergrad and then also 18 credits of my graduate school. So that those 2 years were very, very intense for me. And then on top of that, I have to play in the orchestra. I'm learning a totally new system of music, holding the violin in ways that I'm not used to at all, you know, standing up and playing, and repertoire where I don't even know to read music, sheet music. But then, I always thank, there is something very beautiful about the learning of Indian classical music. I go back to that. It prepares you for learning any other kind of music. As a corollary, I can look back and say that even in terms of world music, in terms of jazz, in terms of fusion, you will see that the Carnatic musician happens to be the force around which he can interact with any other system, any other musical system. Now, Perumbeki Solalai is the objective of Solalai. So there must be something in that learning where if you somewhat master the Indian classical system, you are prepared to take on anybody, any other kind of music. So for me to be able to excel in that also was, I give credit to my classical training. At the end of 2 years, I stood first in my class in Western classical violin. And I had to give a full-fledged 2-hour recital. You know, standing up, tuxedo and bow tie, all the taking a bow and taking all that. So that was a lot of hard work. I still remember spending whole nights. But of course, the facilities that the US gives is amazing for students. If you really want to work hard, all the resources at your disposal.
How did you find time for romance?
Huh?
How did you find time
for romance? So, okay, we'll come to your idea of romance later. According to me, working very, very hard, sadhana is romance. Romance is not a separate category where, you know, sadhana is a process of loving what you do. So music is also like that. Sadhana for music is that. The deeper you go, it's not an outward kind of romance that we are used to, sitting under the moon or a candlelight dinner. It's that idea of romance is very different. Romance is loving such something so intensely that you don't even need to show it out. There is no need to say I'm romantic. If you are romantic, you are romantic. There's no need to have the world acknowledge that. You understand what I'm saying? The word romance comes from the word romanchak. Romanchak, which is a Sanskrit word, since you brought it up, which means rom, your excitement within. And your love for something within is so huge that it makes your hair stand on end. Roma is hair. So romanchak, the word romance is derived from that Sanskritic root of romanchak. So romance, each of us can define it in our own ways. So the romance of music is liking something so deeply and so intrinsically that even sadhana is part of the romance. Today when I sang Bhagyashree in the beginning of this presentation, my eyes are closed, I have made a lot of mistakes. But my 5 minute journey with Bhagyashree, the joy is known to me. According to me, that is very, very romantic. So the idea of romance is what you choose to. Maybe I'm not sharing the same space that you're giving to romance as you have in your mind. But this is what I feel.
If you are meeting your better half, then that's
a different kind of romance. So let us fast forward to that. So I did my Masters of Music in Akron. Then I wanted to get back to my Indian music roots. Then I found a space to do scholarship in Indian music at Wesleyan University in Connecticut, which is one of the world's best universities for world music. I also wanted to have an opportunity to look at music from all over the world. So we had artists in residence at Wesleyan from 8 different countries. So it gave us the time to give me the opportunity to learn. Anuradha came the year I got selected. Because I got selected, she didn't get selected. So I was first in line. So the next year she came. And then we went there. So then today we are at a point where we decided to come back and to roots, and since last 20 years we have been doing many different things within the spectrum of Indian classical music, performance, teaching, exploring other avenues also like film. But I'm kind of back to my roots. I'm very classical in that sense. My consciousness is more Indian classical. Even though I sometimes venture out, I come back with more vehemently I come into classical music. So that's basically music is can be a very important force. Since you're all rasikas, at some point or the other, you all like to listen to Indian classical music.
Yeah.
You all listen to Indian classical music. So it can be a very, very beautiful joy giver. You know, and it's very unconditional. Nothing, very, very few things in our lives give us joy unconditionally. Music is one such. So if you have that inclination, you should hold on to it. If not, you should never give it up. That is something which will take you through, which will give you beautiful times. Throughout, come what may. Business up, down, market up, down, health up, down, whatever, you know. But if you are able to keep your connection with classical music, even popular music to an extent, yes, but popular music keeps changing. And it is still linked to so many other factors that, you know, it's very difficult to keep a lifelong connection with it in a very steadfast manner because things keep changing. So much. So you will keep saying, Andhagalatla Vairo, Kannadasana Vaidhana Mariipo, lyrics say that. So all those kinds of comparisons and things will come up and then you lose touch also. But then classical music is something which kind of in your lifetime it remains a constant companion. So it's a source of extreme oral joy, listening joy. If you get a little deeper into it as a rasika, and if you develop a greater affinity to it, you start discovering a lot of yourselves in the music also. You know, so as a concluding remark, if there are some questions, yes, I can take. But for me, music has been my fountain of joy. Ananda, as they say. It gives me a reason to wake up every morning and practice, do my sadhana. It also is a great source of joy for me to be a teacher of music. Because there is a cyclicity, a continuity that I am responsible for. Because this is an oral tradition. It's a tradition which keeps passing from one guru to the next generation, and those people take it up and teach. So even today, things are changing slightly. My guru used to say, as he used to say, your status in society was not at his time was not dependent on how great a musician or how popular you are or how much you get paid or what awards you've got. It always depended on how many good students you have generated. That was a yardstick. Ki aapne kitna shagird paila kiya. How many students have you left behind? Awards, Padma Shri, Bhushan, all of them can be purchased now. All of you know that. You know, it's a marketplace. But then, preparing a student is, it requires genuine effort on the part of both the Shishya and the Guru. So that is also bringing a lot of joy to my life for the past 10 years. I love teaching as much as I love performing. I like to explore and know more about, learn new things. I was at a seminar in Delhi last week. I ended up buying some 25 CDs of things which I wanted to learn, of different composition, different gharanas, different schools of singing, tumris, tappas, all that. I know they sleep on my shelf, but at least the intention to want to learn was there at that impulse moment of time there. And I will get down to learning some more. So the learning thing is a constant for me. The performance and proficiency is is a byproduct. The learning thing, I continue to learn from Professor S. R. Janakiraman. I continue to learn from Rajan Mishraji in Delhi. I go to Delhi to learn from him once in a while. So these things, the learning impetus is still very, very high. Because in the act of teaching music, you realize how much more there is to know. So you are also simultaneously, you are impelled to be a student also. So wish you all great joy. Listening to being part of this journey. Thank you very much for having me. If you want me to say something, I can. If you have something particular that you want.
Is there an affinity between engineering and music? Because so many of today's youngsters, they do engineering and then take up music.
No real affinity, I would say. Like I say, engineering people do as a matter